So, I did it. I picked From Justin to Kelly, and that's a movie that has lived rent-free in my brain since I saw it as a kid. It's a total disaster that is tailor-made for your show, with a legacy as the movie that Kelly Clarkson campaigned not to get made. I think it's perfect, and I think you're going to hate it.
You know when I pick a movie, that's when I'm under pressure now. The question always comes back to me, what were they thinking now?
Wow, well, call that man Nostradamus, because...
Call him Nostradamus.
Hey, that's my friend in there.
It's fantastic.
Gabe, you have given us a film. This is a podcast, though. This is a podcast called What Were They Thinking? I am Brendan.
And I'm Nathan.
And, of course, we talk about bad to questionable movies. And, Nathan, we are just rounding out... Listener's Choice Month. This is the final stretch, the final episode of the month.
I think the word you're looking for is death knell.
Well, and
mercy,
I did
strike. Coup de grace.
Purposely left this one for the finale, because I think this is the one that when we drew this, there was an audible sigh from both of us and everyone in the room saying, ha ha, ha 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 ha.
You guys were our friends.
They
like
want to
Dave Bautista and Rey Mysterio Jr. I thought you were my friend. Wrestling reference. Got it in
early. Jesus.
You know what? It's better to have it out of the way, because this is a sort of movie that melts the mind and makes you forget everything else that matters in the world. And now I'm drinking.
Oh, I've already got mine open and ready. We are talking about a film. We are talking about a film that Gabe requested, Listener's Choice. We are talking about the 2003 hit film From Justin to Kelly.
You stick an S in front of that, you get my true feelings about this movie.
But yes, this is, when I say hit, first of all, I just want to say something that blew my fucking mind when I read it. Looking at this movie, you'd expect that it was a fairly low budget movie, right?
There is nobody of note in this at the time.
And pretty, like, as far as like big musical numbers, they look like they could have been shot pretty easily.
Those were lackluster, very lackluster.
Okay. So I'm going to tell you that this movie cost $12 million to make.
Oof. It's about $11.5 million too much.
I think they easily could have made it for $500,000. I agree. It made $4 million, which is actually more than I thought it made, because this, I've referenced it before on this show, but this was the movie that came to the theater where I worked and was gone in 3 days.
Oh. So,
From Justin to Kelly, the contractually obligated movie for Justin Guarini and Kelly Clarkson. Of which, I don't know what Justin's take is on this, but Kelly Clarkson, like Gabe said in the open, campaigned hard to not be in the movie. I mean, I think she was more to the point where she's like, I'm not comfortable acting in front of the camera. Like, I'm not an actor. I'd rather just sing. I don't want to be in a musical. I don't want to be in any movie. But the contract said whoever our last two finalists of American Idol are, they're going to be in this movie. Which, wouldn't it have been great if it was two dudes?
That would have been fantastic. Groundbreaking.
But I wonder...
They would have just made it like, two guys competing for the girl.
Yeah.
Yeah.
And the girl would have been the girl that plays Alexa in the movie or something.
Probably.
But yeah, this movie, wow, okay, let's get into the plot real quick. This is a movie where Kelly Clarkson playing Kelly and Justin Guarini playing Justin. You don't want to confuse the audience.
Has he done anything since this? Like, is he still doing stuff?
I don't think so.
Okay.
Like, I mean,
I'm assuming I hope he's still drawing breath, but I mean, like, you know, I haven't really, yeah, I haven't heard too much of anything that he would be, you know, doing as an artist in any way.
Yeah,
I could be wrong.
Maybe he's still like low key putting out music. I'm really not sure. Well, I mean,
that's fair too, because there are a lot of people who do make a living at this sort of gig. They don't make, they're not famous. They're not, you know, they're on the it list every year. Maybe they're on the shit list every year, but they're not on the it list every year. But they still manage to grind out a living, going to, like, you know, county fairs and roller rinks and stuff like that, getting paid a few $100 a night to sing some songs and be, you know, someone who was on American Idol.
So. Well, thankfully, one Miss Kelly Clarkson did escape from this and has.
Well,
had
yeah,
a
only because
career.
She did an about face after yeah. that first album she had to put out was out. And then she was like, thanks, now I'm going to do the stuff I want to do.
Right, exactly. She took control of her own career, and good on you. And you're yeah. doing well. So, and she's delightful, honestly, in general. Like, yeah. Like 99.5% of the time, this is just not a good fit for anyone. Yeah. Anyone in this movie.
Plot.
But yeah, so there are a couple of kids, a couple teens, I guess, or the college students. But she is dragged to spring break by her friends, whereas Justin Guarini owns a party company or something. We'll get into that with his two friends, and they're there as well. And of course, you know, they meet up. There's a lot of music, dancing, many misconceptions. A lot of people, I would say everyone in this movie is pretty brain dead. And
or just flat out sociopathic,
yeah, or very domineering, I would say at times too. Hilarity ensues,
not intentional hilarity, but
no, but there is a lot of unintentional hilarity. I had some pretty good laughs at some of the terrible things in this movie,
yeah.
But like you say, Nathan, pitter patter,
let's get at her.
We start with Kellyoke Clarkson.
Yeah.
What I thought was Kellyoke, because it sure seemed like she was just doing a karaoke performance at the beginning.
Yeah, you don't realize, like, there's an actual backing band and stuff there for her one person show for poor Luke, who, you know, just wants Kelly to give him a chance.
Oh, that old country boy Luke. He's like, oh, I'll tell you something, Kelly. You Hurricane Luke gonna blow you over. I'm like, no game.
I do feel bad for this poor guy, though. I honestly do, because you can see that the guy, he's not asking for the world. He just wants a chance, and she's not giving it to him.
Yeah, I mean, she's definitely not, like, making him think it's something, though. I mean,
no, this is true.
Curt.
She's not. Yeah, she's not leading him on, and she is upfront about it. But it still doesn't take the sting away when you're in that situation.
Yeah. I mean, he's certainly not the worst person in this movie by far.
No, as a matter of fact, I would say in all of this, he's the victim.
Okay.
Just because of what happens at the end.
Oh, that's. That's insane. I can't believe they even... Yeah, when they went there, I was shocked. Oh, by the way, we know that her name is Kelly because she has a shirt with a K on it, just in case anyone gets confused.
Oh, even if you didn't, I mean, her name is said, like, what, conservatively 10 times in the first 5 minutes.
Yep.
The girls in this movie, most of the time, are just talking to each other like it's a soap opera. You ever had to, like, endure a soap opera, like your mom or your aunt who watches soap operas, and you just kind of had to watch them in the afternoons, you know, when you were a kid in school. Everybody addresses everybody else, but like with first names almost exclusively.
Mm-hmm.
So like it, like if we were in a soap opera, Brendan, right now, Brendan, I would tell you, Brendan, that I don't care much for this movie, Brendan.
Well, like, Nathan,
they
I would respond to you, Nathan, by saying that Nathan, I did. I mean, I'm not to blame here, Nathan. This was picked by someone else, Nathan.
What's his name? Because you have to say his name 100 times too.
Oh well, Gabe picked this movie, and Gabe wanted to make us watch this movie because Gabe knew it was going to be a bad movie that we'd make fun of. And thanks, Gabe.
Gabe.
But we quickly meet two other characters. We meet Kelly's friends. One is Kaya. And I was surprised that this movie had a black cast member, so kudos. Because this is almost the whitest movie I've ever seen. Kaya and her other friend is Alexa, who as soon as she enters, I mean, she's got the name Alexa. She's got long blonde hair, and she has a bit of a sneer on her face. I'm like, uh-oh, we got the party girl. And she even calls herself a party girl, because this is PG, and you can't say the S word.
Right. Well, but I mean, maybe I don't think that's fair anyways.
What?
Slut shaming. It's entirely unfair. I mean, why can't women like sex too?
Oh no, 100%. But I'm just saying, like, that's the caricature she's playing for sure.
Yeah.
But they really want to go on spring break, and they can't. They said the airline they were going to take has gone bankrupt apparently overnight. And so
don't laugh. That happened a couple years ago.
Just like that, no warning?
Yep. No warning. The people who were supposed to fly that day did not fly that day.
Are you saying
no one was given warning?
Are you saying that this film was prescient?
Maybe. Or just, you know, got one thing right about how the real world works.
Oh, yeah, because there's not... I mean, savor that, folks, because there ain't much of that in this movie. But yeah, they're like, oh, we wanted to go to spring break. Alexa bought 23 bikinis. And I'm like, that's what an insane person does. And
how did,
like,
she get away with that now?
What, buying 23 bikinis?
Yeah, did you catch how she managed to get away with doing that? Without getting in trouble with her parents? I just told my daddy that my therapist's name were Neiman and Marcus.
Jesus. Yeah. So they're like, Kelly... We know someone with a car. Oh, FYI, it's you. Drive us to spring break, Kelly. And she's like, I don't know. Turns around and sees Luke stumble over himself and says, oh, okay. Like, it doesn't take much. It doesn't take much to convince her. And then we get our first real big song of the movie. That song that's like, vacation all I ever wanted.
Fucking song. As soon as I heard that, I knew right away that I was going to have the daggers out for this movie. Like, right away. That is a sacrilege. That is a cover of a classic song by the Go-Go's.
Okay.
And this is a garbage cover. Garbage!
Well, Nathan, keep your fervor for garbage covers later, because there's another one coming later on in the movie. I knew that was a real song. It was like a song. I knew I'd heard that before, and I said, but this doesn't sound like it should sound. So that makes a lot of sense.
Yeah.
But yeah, they're going to spring break, and then we cut away because we got to meet the fellas.
Oh, before we do that, I would like to note that I did like how they handled the credits sequence. Other than the shitty Go-Go's cover, like how they were inserting like the production names into like a lot of like billboards and signage that you saw as you're going through the opening credits. That was actually kind of neat. So that goes into the good column for this terrible, awful, dreadful movie.
But they did seem to give up on that about three quarters of the way through the opening.
Well, they gave up on it, and then they went back to it, and then they gave up on it again, and they finally went back to it at the very end, where you can see like the director's name being flown over the beach by a plane, like you know, like that one that said TikTok to Matt Gates.
Oh boy. Jail.
And interestingly enough, also in Florida. So,
what? Is this his origin story? Oh shit! Is he Brandon? Is that a young Matt Gates?
I wouldn't be the shocked in the least.
But yeah, so we meet the fellas. We get Justin Guarini, and his friends are Brandon and this guy that's like the nerd guy.
I thought his name was Ed.
The nerd
I thought
guy?
It was yeah, I thought it was Ed or Eddie or something like that. Yeah, they only say his name. This is like, he's one of the only people in this movie that don't get the soap opera treatment.
Yeah, well, they don't want you to know him, yeah. Nathan, because he's a nerd.
Well, he's got a Kangol pit helmet. So. He looks like, you know, like one of those you know, British explorers in the deepest, darkest jungles with that pit helmet on, but it's a fuzzy soft thing with a little kangaroo logo on it.
All of the clothes in this movie are insane.
This movie made me want to, like, I don't know, like, stab people or, you know, light things on fire. This movie took me to a dark. I do not identify with anybody in this cast.
Well, I was very disappointed that the guy with the name closest to my name was the worst person in the world.
Well, I mean, at least it's not exactly your name, because can you imagine?
Oh God. So yeah, they're chatting, they're being bros, and they're talking about, and they have a party company or something, which I don't fully understand what they are. They're like
they frame it like that, but that's exactly what it is. They're up and coming event planners, because everything that they do, or mostly, you know, Brandon, everything they do, it's all has to be put together. There has to be, like, you know, drink specials have to be arranged, bracelets have to be purchased, there has to be security. These guys are event planners, but no kid who's watching American Idol at the time is going to be like, man, I want to be just like those event planners.
Yeah,
like,
I thought it was such
I want a party company too. Woo!
I thought it was such a weird occupation for them to have. I'm like, why not just have them be like guys going to a party? Like, guys going on spring break.
Because then we couldn't really truly appreciate the skeeviness of Brandon like throughout. Because yeah, sure, you can make him, you know, kind of a, you know, misogynist drunkard jock douchebag, but if you can make him a misogynist drunkard jock douchebag who will do anything for a dollar, oh man, you've got, you know, that's the evil Quinella.
Well, they do talk about how they're planning this big whipped cream bikini contest and. Yeah, there's a scene with it later, but really the way they're hyping it, you think it's going to be like the centerpiece of the movie.
Yeah.
But
he gives it like a really terrible rap and moons people. So,
oh yeah. Yeah.
In case you weren't totally sold on Brandon being the absolute worst.
So dude, you want to pick up chicks? I'll give you the secret. You want mad phone numbers and make them beg you to keep it? You'll be heartbreaking Betty, yet heart busting. Just follow me and Justin, and soon they'll be lusting for you. Now, to impress these chicks, you gotta be smoother than ever. No need to sweat. I'm your mentor. I'm clever. The ones at the bar and the ones at the pool. The triplets Cammy, Sammy, and Tammy from my old high school. But it's cool, because I rule. Multiple chicks will be landing. Just listen to Brandon, and soon they'll be standing with you. You can leave them all smitten. Names like Honey and Baby and Bunny and Kitten. You listening? Because you now are a player. Just stack up the layers on your heart and then save. This flavor of freedom, we gotta date him and leave him. Goodbye, see you later, catch him maybe next season. So you ready now, Eddie? You're a chick-sicking missile. So follow my plan and make all the girls whistle.
Meanwhile, the nerd dude, I guess we're calling him Eddie, are we? Ed?
I'll go with Eddie, yeah.
Okay. Well, Eddie talks about how he's been in a cyber relationship. He's been dating someone on the internet for a year. And says, you know, in case you don't know, he's a nerd, guys. He says, well, you should see her website. It's really well designed.
Mm-hmm.
And, you know, he makes Star Trek references and stuff. At least he doesn't make Star Trek and Star Wars references together. We'll say that.
And at least the girls in this movie aren't cheerleader ninjas.
Oh, spoiler alert. As bad as this movie is, better than cheerleader ninjas.
Yes. I'm not going to say against that. No.
But like, man, some horrible writing in this, in the whole movie, but especially here. Cause they're like, oh, Justin, you say you're different now, but you should tell those 400 girls last year. Or like, oh, Brandon, you're physically incapable. You're genetically incapable of being in a relationship, but doesn't that make you sad? Aren't you just scared of commitment? And I'm like, wow.
I believe he thanks God for being genetically engineered to not be in a stable relationship.
Yeah.
He takes a brief second, looks up and says, thank you. So he's a God-fearing scumbag, I guess.
Well, he was actually in the extended cut of The Encounter. He was in that cafe, too. And Jesus was like, and Brandon, you know, just keep being you.
You're doing good. You're doing real good.
I get to sneak a peek each time.
Jesus.
But we have a big beach party. There's a DJ. Everyone's having fun and dancing. And we go back to the girls, and Alexa is already on the prowl. She is looking to get laid, as was anybody at that one of those things.
Oh, it's spring break, right? I mean, yeah. I don't identify with just about anybody in this movie, because, spoiler alert, I've never been on a spring break like this. So I don't know, man. There's just something so vapid and anti-me that this movie's all about.
Well, we have our first musical number here,
which started out as original soundtrack. You just hear the soundtrack, and there's some singing and stuff like that. So you think it's just a song that's being spun at this party by the DJ, and then oh nope, they're singing. Everybody's singing.
Everybody's singing. Everybody knows the words to this song that was written for the movie,
and the intricate choreography.
Attraction, are you looking for distraction? Will you find it here in me? Tall, short, dark, blonde, who's the right decision? Boy, I need a vision if you wanna dance with me.
Did that girl just look my way? Look like she just wants to play. So go over, no, I'll stay. Cause I don't know just what you say.
Tell me where you're from. Don't I know you from back home? Need to be alone.
Cause tomorrow you'll be gone.
All the girls gonna shake it in the bounce tonight. Gonna do it like a girl when the bounce is right. If it's cool, we can walk until the morning light. Can you feel the vibe? Cause I'm looking for you. And the stars will be checking all the ladies right. And if they're in the mood, then it's on tonight. All we wanna do is rock until the bounce is right. Make them feel the love vibes.
I have a question. Now, this is something I've heard, and I don't know if it's true. I think it's just a rumor, but I've heard rumors that this, after this was written, and yes, this was a script that was written down on paper or typed. Apparently, the rumor is
pooped into a ream of paper and threw it at a wall.
Well, whatever way they ended up writing it.
Yeah.
The rumor is that they had forgotten that it was a musical, and that apparently they wrote the songs in like a day or two.
You know, I can't fault that too much when it comes to writing like a radio hit, like a song that you're going to put on an album or something like that. But when you're talking about an entire score for a movie, not necessarily score, but, you know, a complete soundtrack that these people are supposed to be singing to get across their feelings in this movie, you take a bit more than a day.
Yes, and you'd think that as bad as this movie would be, you'd think that music would be the one thing they would focus on the most.
Considering.
Seeing as how you have two people from American Idol, it's a musical, and you're appealing to American Idol fans.
Oh, did you happen to catch what Brandon and Eddie and Justin call themselves?
I believe the Pennsylvania Posse.
Christ, that is the squarest fucking name.
You know they wanted to call it the Pennsylvania Pussy Posse.
Well, I mean, yeah, but then, you know, you can't get that that hard R.
No, you gotta, this is a very light PG. Although there are moments where I questioned it. But anyway. So yeah, they're all dancing, they're all having fun. Justin and Kelly already meet in the midst of this dance number and immediately fall in love. Like, he's like, there's something about that girl. And I'm like, what are you talking about, dude? She, like, you did, like, a twirl, and then she, like, walked away.
Like, yeah. Well, because, yeah, because they met each other they encounter each other on the beach. Then they meet up again here. And then there's all this whole, like, oh, gosh, they can't seem to find each other in the crowd. Whatever will they do moments throughout this song. And then I got a thing here where dude is like handing out bracelets and Justin has to like get away and he does end up finding Kelly in the ladies' bathroom.
Oh, that's when everybody's hounding Justin to get on this margarita madness list. And I'm like, what are you talking about? Movie, like, introduce this concept, because I don't know what you're talking about.
Yeah, please show us. Don't tell us. But he gets chased by a bunch of girls who want to get the bracelets and get in to this Margarita Madness thing.
Yeah.
He encounters Kelly in the bathroom. They have a little exchange, and she helps him escape via the window. And there's, you know, there's some lines that were obviously thrown in for the punch up, like things like, I can't even fit my hair through that thing, where he's talking about the window, because he's got mm-hmm. you know, big puffy hair. Of course, she pushes him up out through the window, and you hear like, oh, my body, I'm releasing broken, falling. Like, it's just ADR hilarity. Like, you can't see either one of their faces, and the sound is so different that you can tell that this was done in post.
Yeah, and you also have, like, the lines, when they get to the bathroom, the lines in that scene are crazy. Like, Kelly is like, oh, yeah, I'm going to let you in on a little secret. Every ladies' room has a secret escape door. I'm like, okay, hold on a second. Now, not that I would know, but I feel like that's a lie.
Well, it's the window. That's the gag.
But not every ladies' room has a window to get out.
No, but, you know, for, you know, the purposes of this.
She also says, she also introduces herself. My friends call me Kelly for short.
Oh, hey, we met at the beach, right?
Yeah, my friends call me Kelly for short.
I'm like, I get it if your name is Kellyanne. I do. People are named Kellyanne or whatever. But mm-hmm. normally when you say your name is Kelly, you don't just say, well, my friends call me Kelly for short. Like, you could just say, my name is Kelly.
Well, that it's not just that. Normally you lead with something longer first. I don't know. Like, my name's Benjamin, but my friends call me Ben. Yeah. Yeah. That's how that's worked. You don't just go, like, my friends call me Kelly for short. Well, if that were me in that situation, I'd be like, well, what do they call you for long? Because nobody talks like that.
That's the thing, though, too. I was just like, yeah, you're just like, yeah, your name's Kelly. Okay, cool. Just say your name's Kelly.
That's all I got to do.
Even Benjamin, you just say, yeah, it's Ben. Just call me Ben. Yeah. But yeah, she helps him escape. And then she's like, you know, call me, writes her name.
On the line, call me. Call me. Way better song.
Unfortunately, they didn't do a great cover of that song in this movie. But she throws a note outside with her number on it, lands in the water.
Yeah, he's right there. There's no reason why she can't just hand him that note.
That, and also, he immediately sees it land in the water, so why not go, oh, hey, Kelly.
It fell in the water.
Yeah, exactly. Can you just tell me what your number is? Because, yeah, okay, cool, thanks. Movie doesn't need to happen.
Mm-hmm.
Also, at this point, we should also talk about the B, C, D story, I guess, of Brandon and the cop.
And well, there's Brandon and the cop. There's that thing.
Keeps finding him for, like you said, mooning, and then later he like runs into a stand, and he gets another fine, and he gets a fine for gambling, and he's like, man, she's so hot, she keeps fining me.
Yeah, and the other one being Kaya and
Carlos.
Carlos, yes. Which is like the setups or the scenes for a lot of these parts of the story, for lack of a better term, are just such one-off throwaway scenes that they're just shoehorned, and sometimes the light is even wrong because it was day a second ago.
Mm-hmm.
And like she at one point here, this when Kaya first meets Carlos, she is kind of complaining because she just spilled a drink on her favorite outfit, her beach outfit. It's a clear drink. There's no stain. Carlos says, "Here, I'll help you remove that stain
with club soda."
But there's no stain.
Literally the same color as the club soda.
Yeah. And we don't get too much time to think about that, because then we go to the next scene where I think Alexa is on a beach bed.
Yes,
are those beds
you.
For beach fucking?
What the fuck was that?
That's the weirdest thing I've ever seen.
It looks almost like it looks almost like there's a bar here in Fredericton that has these like cushions set up that kind of looks like a bed, but it's like, you know, in the corner or whatever, there's like a few cushions all together. But this was like, this had fucking drapes and like
this is a full on Mark McGrath. Four corners to this four poster bed. with curtains and everything that you could draw. So if you wanted to do, you know, some boning on the beach, they got you covered, I guess.
But yeah, Alexa is like, gives Justin Kelly's number because he said, hey, you're her friend. What's your friend's number? Because she gave it to me and it got totally wet. And apparently I had no voice for about 30 seconds to yell after her. Yeah. So she's like, yeah, this is totally Kelly's number. Wah, wah, wah. It's Alexa's number.
Which tells you right away, begs the question, why are they friends with her?
She's awful.
She is an awful, awful person.
She's, yeah. I mean, like, you know, the movie tries to get you to think that she's awful for being a party girl. She's not awful for being a party girl. She's awful because she's an awful human being.
Yes, because she is a manipulative sociopath.
Mm-hmm. But yeah, she gives him the number, and but Justin is so, he's so dumb because he clearly, Kelly and he had like a little connection earlier, and he messages her, and then Alexa texts him back and says, not interested. And he goes, oh man. Like,
yeah,
I guess not.
Despite the fact that when she gave him the number, she was like, call me.
Yeah.
Like, there's clearly also some vibes there.
Also, why doesn't he ever call? Why doesn't he ever try to call the number? Especially because Alexa literally says, oh, you should call her at this number.
Yeah.
By the way, the screens showing the text messages was really funny. It just reminded me of a time when texting wasn't a big thing.
Yeah, no Nokia phones.
Yeah.
And interestingly enough, it's one of those things where you're like, okay, so she's got a Nokia. Obviously, this is it's a slice of the time. 2003, those are the types of phones that you were dealing with, which actually kind of made people be like, if I want to set up plans, I have to call. Because first of all, kids, just so you know, we had to pay for each text message.
Each one.
And also, if you wanted to type something out, you had to press several buttons just to spell out a simple word. Like, if you wanted to spell, let's say you wanted to spell beach, you would have to press 2, 2, then pause, 3, 3, pause, 2, pause, 2, 2, 2, pause, 4, 4, pause. That's how you spelled beach.
Guys.
Beach.
It's not as good as it used to be.
Right.
Those were the good old days when it took you a good hour to spell out a sentence.
Yeah. So just to let you know, anybody who ever pines for quote unquote the good old days, tell them to shut the hell up.
Yeah. One of many things that are much better now.
Yes.
We go back to Kaya's whole story with Carlos, because the funny thing is their conflict is he's very embarrassed that he has a job, I guess.
Yeah, that son of a bitch.
Because he's just like, he works clearing tables, and he's like, oh, I'm not exactly on vacation here. And I was like, okay, I thought that you were going to be ashamed because you were a 35-year-old man, but I guess that's just what you're ashamed of. Okay.
Yeah. And like you said, it's real sloppy narrative the way they jump to and fro with these stories. There's nothing that ever feels like that they're happening in any sort of linear fashion.
No, and then sometimes they'll just have like scenes outside where it'll be like, you could tell it's like sunny, but and then all of a sudden they'll cut and you could tell there's like overcast, and it's just nothing matches.
No.
But Kaya and Carlos have a little salsa date.
They're not going to like buy salsa. They're going to go dance salsa.
That sounds way cooler.
We're going to go around and try different salsas. There's a craft salsa maker here in Miami Beach, and they did this mango salsa that's just, it's just got the right amount of sweet and heat. That's not overpowering, yeah. But they also do a nice habanero if the spice is your thing.
Yeah, let's do shots, guys. Like, the next day, they're just shit in their pants.
It burns. It burns. Someone give me some ice for my brown eye.
Just here. Ah!
I would have loved this movie so much more if that had been the case.
Oh, that would have been so good. That, you know what though? That would be in like the parody movie, and it wouldn't be good.
It wouldn't. That would be like a Friedberg fucking movie where they put it out that year just to cash in on it, and then you're like, oh, I get what they're doing here. Ha 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 ha.
One of the 75 million fart jokes in Cheerleader Ninjas.
Yeah. Wet, juicy farts.
So yeah, they have a musical number. Again, I keep saying there's a musical number. I don't remember what any of the songs are.
Oh, me neither.
And they just go right through your brain.
And they're all, well, like you said, they wrote it all in a day.
That's the rumor.
And that's the thing, like, yeah, there are memorable pop songs that have like a really good hook to them and that they stick with you. They're kind of timeless. I can think of stuff that, you know, is done by, you know, I don't know, Prince, Michael Jackson.
Well, even like
George Michael,
the star of the movie, Kelly Clarkson, has had songs that I remember. I hear right. them starting up, and I'm like, oh, I know the words to this one.
Right. That it is not the case with the songs. These are all just instantly forgettable unless they make you see red in a blinding rage, like that Vacation cover at the first.
But again, that's a real song, so that's, you already know it, right?
Right, and I'm righteously angry because they dared try to cover it. Bastards.
So they have a nice little date and everything's going well. Alexa at this point decides to play around with this whole Justin and Kelly possible blossoming relationship. Is that she tells Kelly, hey, let's go down to the beach instead and see if Justin's there. And they enter Kelly into the whipped cream bikini contest. Folks, it's what we've all been waiting for.
It's Kelly Clarkson in a whipped cream bikini.
But she is quickly like, hell no.
Nah.
I'm not doing that. She sees that Justin is one of the people organizing it, and instantly her opinion of him goes down considerably.
Which, you know, understandable. I have to question the friend's reasoning on this whole let's bring Kelly to spring break decision. Given that you know what she's like, she clearly has, you know, opinions, and she thinks a lot of the things that are apparently either done on spring break are degrading.
She's not wrong, but I know what you mean. Like, maybe this isn't the place for her.
Right.
Yeah. So she pretends like, oh yeah, yeah, put the whipped cream bikini on, whatever. And then of course puts it right in Justin's face. Oh.
But he spins it around and makes it like, you know, a fun thing, which turns into a whipped cream fighting contest.
Meanwhile, we get the F plot of Eddie waiting for his internet date, and he keeps missing her in like several scenes. And the first one, he misses her because this guy's like, "Hey, dude, we're missing one person for our volleyball game, bro. Come on and fill in."
And he's not dressed for volleyball.
Not at all.
No, just standing around with his beach formal wear, waiting for his girl. But they managed to convince him.
Yeah, he's like, I'm waiting for my internet girlfriend. Actually, we met in a Xena chat room, and I'm like, do you have to tell everyone every detail?
Also, man, you want a movie to have some semblance of timelessness.
Yeah, Xena. What are you talking about?
Right. I don't feel that a syndicated Sam Raimi show is going to do that for you.
It was great back in the day, though.
Well, you know what? I never really watched it. I have heard a lot of good things about it. But if you're going to take a movie and you want to make it as, you know, as timeless as you can, you pick something that's definitely got like a proven background. So, I mean, Star Trek, Star Wars, Dungeons and Dragons.
Yeah.
Even, you know what? Even Lord of the Rings at that time.
Well, he could have said a lot of things. He could have mentioned Red Dwarf. He could have mentioned Battlestar Galactica. He could have mentioned Babylon 5.
Yeah. 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 Nope.
Xena. Oh, if only we had gotten a Lucy Lawless cameo.
That would have been delightful.
She's wonderful. Mm-hmm. So yeah, he gets dragged to the volleyball game, and then we see, uh-oh, his internet date shows up and he's not around, which I thought it was a bad choice to reveal what she looked like early on, because I think it would have been funny if they were like, oh, she's probably a guy, or she's probably a hog or something like that, and then, you know, reveal that she's not that, any of those things. Justin, meanwhile, tries to make up with Kelly, and he ends up spilling hot sauce all over her lap. I just say this, like, I think these two are trying their very best, but I don't think Justin Guarini was meant for physical comedy.
But see, that's the thing. You see that hair, and they even make mention of him in this movie. You think Sideshow Bob. So, I mean.
Yeah, it gets mentioned. That's right.
And so, I mean, that with hair like Harpo Marx, you think that there's gonna be some funny going on there, because the hair is clearly whimsical, rather than, you know, genetic.
Now you're making me think how much more I would have rather watched Duck Soup,
or Thrashing with his grandson in it.
No, you be there, Nathan.
You be there.
Oh, you be there.
This is one of the first, like, you must be an idiot moments.
Thank you.
He says,
we're still on for the marina at four.
Yeah, we're still on for the marina at four. And she goes, yeah. And then pauses, still on. Doesn't follow up with that.
No, doesn't say, what do you mean still on? This is the first time you've asked me to the marina. And then he'd be like, no, I texted you here. This is where I texted you. See, I asked you if you wanted to go to the marina. Here's your number that I texted.
This movie would have been solved so quickly if people in it had a conversation.
Like, no. Which is one the case with every fucking romantic comedy.
Well, everyone that we've talked about, anyway.
Just about everyone that I've ever seen.
Yeah, they're going to meet at the marina, and they go on a boat ride. A romantic boat ride.
Motherfucker. On a boat.
Don't you ever forget. Yeah. Never thought they'd be on a boat. But so they're on this boat ride, and Kelly is like, you know, this must be where you take all your girls. And he says, no, I just come out here to think. What are you talking about? Do you live here?
Thank you, because he's part of the Pennsylvania posse.
Yeah. No, you don't, dude. This is not Pennsylvania.
But that's the thing. If he was, he could be, because as explored in the movie Striking Distance, just way better than this movie, there are three rivers in that city in Pennsylvania.
But he also, I was hoping then in the spirit of Striking Distance, since they said Justin had been with like 400 women, where were all his autographed pictures
of those girls? He doesn't live there. They're at home on his wall in his houseboat.
Lining like three rooms.
That's just, there's no wallpaper. It's just autographed pictures of his girlfriends.
That's what that movie Four Rooms is about, right?
Yeah. Yep.
That'd be terrifying to walk into. What are all these pictures? Oh my God.
Did you ever see the movie Switchback? Mm-mm. With Danny, it's got Danny Glover and Dennis Quaid in it, and it's a serial killer detective type movie. I'm not going to spoil anything for you, except for this one scene where Danny Glover first meets Dennis Quaid, and he's driving around in a car that is upholstered with pictures from nudie magazines, and not like tasteful Playboy ones.
It's funny you mention that, because actually I just recently watched the trailer for that movie, because Gabe, a little tie into this episode, my friend Gabe, who also requested this movie, we were potentially going to watch that because we watched like a shitty movie every 2 weeks, but ended up going with something else. But that was one of the potential candidates. So I actually just recently watched the trailer for that. So
it just came into your orbit, eh?
Yeah. It was like Dennis Quaid and Danny Glover. I'm in. So yeah, they're on the boat. They have a duet on the boat.
Dialogue and songs in this fucking movie are just insufferable.
Oh man,
we're up to our, but this is our third song right now. And I was just like, oh. Shoot me, shoot me, shoot me, shoot me.
At least it's not one after the other.
No, it could have been. Yes, it could have been. And we could have ended up in a real Cats Grease type situation here had they put a second thought into writing the songs for the movie starring two people who were finalists in a song singing competition.
The crazy thing is that, like, well, like Grease, I remember like most of those songs. Like, I can remember, I hear them and I'm like, I know what that is right away. And the other one you mentioned, Cats, like, obviously Cats is a disaster piece, but like, those songs are kind of memorable in a bad
because they're from a super successful Broadway musical, yeah, just like Grease was.
Yeah. So after the boat scene, we get more of Kaya and Carla. She goes into where he works and she's very excited because they're going to go out that night. His boss shows up and says, okay, hey,
let's back this truck up for just a half a second. What is she doing in the kitchen? Unless you work there or have business in that restaurant, people do not just go to the kitchen.
Oh.
She would have showed up in there. Yeah, he might have said hi to her, but three other people working in that kitchen would have been like, you need to get out.
Yeah, she probably shouldn't be back there.
She shouldn't. And she proves it with what's coming up next.
Well, his boss is like, nope, need you to work the night shift. And she says, hey, you know what? You overworked this guy. You're treating him like crap. And he says, okay, fine, you're fired then.
Which I'm not sure what the labor laws are, but if he's been there for more than 3 months, he can't do that.
No, I'm pretty sure. Yeah. Well, there's so many movies where that happens though, where someone is like, you're fired. And I'm like, wait, you just said they had been with the company for 25 years. I don't think you can just boom, boom, you're done.
Yeah, unless it's a corporate cutback and people who've been there less than he has have also been cut.
Unless you're Michael Douglas getting accused of sexual assault, I don't think you can just get fired right away.
Right.
Hashtag disclosure.
Justin and Kelly are still having their date because it's wrapping up right now.
At night,
and because don't forget, he gets fired before the night, but it was also kind of night. Anyways, the logistics of the temporal vortex that is this movie, I can't get into it, or I'll have a stroke. What I'm getting at here is that their date ends with a good firm handshake, a nice Republican conservative handshake.
Very, very awkward end of date. Yeah.
Yeah.
And, I mean, that was a long boat ride because it is like 11 o'clock at night, judging from how dark it is.
I think, yeah.
But yeah. And then we get a quick scene of Alexa getting like going into margarita madness and getting a bunch of margaritas dunked on her. Hilarious.
That that scene served no purpose to the plot. Nothing.
No, I was waiting. I was like, okay, where's this go? Oh, it's over. Oh, we're not going back to it. Okay.
Somebody is not going to like help her clean up, and then she's gonna turn her attention to him and leave Kelly and Justin alone. No, okay, yeah. All right, moving on.
Nothing.
Moving on.
Literally just padding for this movie, which there is so much padding for an 81 minute movie. So the next day, the girls are hanging out, and Alexa, they're talking to Alexa about how, you know, we're not quite like you. Like, we're not out to just have fun and be a party girl. And she says, well, maybe I'm more than a party girl.
But proceeds to not try to prove that in any way, shape, or form.
Nope.
We do get a fun, again, another toss-away, one-off scene where Ed is clearly going to become a lobster boy.
Oh, where he
wants to get a tan before he meets his internet lady. He slathers on a bunch of like cocoa butter and stuff like that. He says to Brandon, I think, I've got like 3 hours of prime tanning time. You should not tan for 3 hours.
No, and I think that they really missed the boat with this gag though, because he gets he's supposed to be like, you know, burned and everything, but like they could have gone a lot further with the makeup.
Oh, they really could have, and they could have gone a lot further with the jokes about it too. But you know, this movie's lazy and it doesn't care.
They just have people pointing and laughing as he walks around the beach, and then you see like the reveal is him looking in the mirror, and he's like, "Ah!" And I'm like, "Really, dude? That's not that bad."
And I noted, how does he not feel that? Because when I was a kid, I want to say about 9 or 10, I spent like all day in the water at the lake my parents used to go to in the summers. I never got out and I never put on sunscreen. By the time the evening rolled around, my skin was on fire.
Yeah.
So.
Yeah, it's not something you only know from people pointing at you.
Or just, you know, lightly grazing up against you.
Right. Yeah. But we don't have much time to deal with that because Alexa has to have a musical number here. Again, that's nothing. That's like a Disney villain song, I guess.
Yeah.
Justin is tricked via text message into going to this place called the Pearl, whereas Kelly thinks he's going to meet her at the beach. But oh, lo and behold, Justin goes to the Pearl, and old Alexa is waiting for him.
Mm.
And she says, "You know, Kelly's no good for you, man. Didn't she tell you she has a boyfriend? It's Luke back home."
Yeah,
yeah.
Yeah.
I see what you mean now for feeling bad for. I feel bad for Luke for the following stuff because he's really just thrown into the mix here.
Yeah. Yeah, he is used as a pawn in her deceitful little game.
Yep. But before that can go any further, we also have a guy that bursts into the dude's room and starts trying to beat the fuck out of Eddie because he thinks that Eddie is the one that had sex with his girlfriend, but of course it's Brandon.
I did note that this the boyfriend here is trying to beat up Eddie, named Greg, and he is easily in his 30s.
Yes, thank you. I was like, this is not a college student.
Yeah, no, he is not. No.
And if he is a college student and he went back to college, good for him. But he's not the same age as these people.
No.
and at this point, Eddie basically becomes like his therapist, and he's like,
well he does. Know. He kind of talks him out of getting beat up, and basically saying like, you know, if she was stepping out on you, what were you doing to help, you know, pay attention to her and keep her, sort of thing. And he's like, you know what, you're right, man. You want to like go get a drink or something? And of course, they can't resist making the joke where Eddie has to say, you know, like it's. We're just going to be friends, right? I'm not gay.
Yeah.
They stop short of having him say I'm not gay, but still.
Two guys can't have a drink together without it being a homosexual relationship. So because of this, because he's like helping him out and they're having a chat at the bar, he hugs him at one point and he doubles over. And just at that moment, Eddie's date shows up and misses him again.
He's doubled over because he's still suffering from the third degree sunburn, which now looks like it is 4 weeks old.
Yeah. So
Nathan, another number.
We talked about outfits in this movie. Kelly shows up with fucking, there are literally fucking neckties to make like a skirt. they are literally neckties.
Yeah.
It's the most insane thing. She shows up and they're singing, I don't know, I think this song might be called Must Be the Madness. Again, I don't know how it goes. I don't know any of the words. But Kelly and Kaya are just like dancing defiantly. it's like a aggressive dance off with Justin.
And they've got all this almost like, it's not a cover. You can tell that they lifted some stuff from Staying Alive.
Yeah, because they do have the like dun, 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 dun.
Yeah, and even Kaya has a line that stops. You can tell by the way, and then they change the lyric after that.
Yeah,
and it's some with the same cadence and tone and everything.
You walk out of your life while you talk a lot. You talk a sheet. You change your mind. Like you change your sheet. And me, you're doing things that I don't like. It ain't right. Well, it must be the madness.
Must be the madness and the magic that I feel inside.
So we'll count that as number two of fuck off.
the other big guy who's been trying to catch Brandon, who he keeps voicing off his friends on, he shows up, and this is where he's the one who calls Justin Sideshow Bob.
Right, right.
Yeah. One few times that I legitimately had a laugh in this movie.
At this point, we saw earlier Alexa was calling someone, and that someone was Luke. And Luke shows up and immediately kisses Kelly, which, you know, I said I felt bad for him, but I don't know if that's the best thing to do as soon as you get there.
Let's just wind back for just a half a minute, though. We're talking about Alexa here. She called him to have him come. Now, who's to say that she didn't call him and was like, y'all, Luke, guess what? Kelly, she's here and she's having the worst time. She keeps talking about you. She misses you. She really wants you to come here. She says she's changed her mind. She really wants to give you a chance. That's what, see you in a little bit. Bye.
I don't know. I get that, but I still think maybe say something first.
Does anybody else say something first in this movie?
Well, Justin and Kelly don't kiss yet.
No, I'm talking about, does anybody say anything else? When a simple misunderstanding could have been solved by, oh, by the by.
Well, no.
That never happens.
I mean, this scene where Luke shows up and immediately kisses Kelly, I mean, we have to have this happen because we need this action-packed.
Needlessly complex.
Very complex. Horribly shot. Again, overcast weather during this whole scene of a hovercraft race.
It's not a hovercraft race. That's the thing. Like, if it was just a straightforward race your hovercraft out to the buoy, turn around, come back, first person back wins. Simple. Ba-boom. Done. And Kelly is a piece of meat for you to win. No, you have to drive back and forth with each other, like the jousting match in Thrashing, but not shot in anywhere nearly as well. They have to drive back and forth, passing each other, throwing dodgeballs, trying to score the dodgeball into the basket of the other person's hoverboat.
Mm-hmm. You're right. I don't know why they didn't just make it a race.
I don't know. Either way, it could have led to the episode of Baywatch that followed.
Yeah, because Luke nearly dies.
Yeah.
Imagine if they had just had him die.
That would have been, you know what? I would have been like, you know what? I see you, movie. Bold choice.
5 stars.
It would get bumped up at least a half a star for doing that. For me, anyway.
So half a star total.
Half a star. Half a stars.
Luke gets like 7 stitches or whatever, and... Yeah. I think I mentioned it earlier, but we're still doing the thing with Brandon and the cop, because the cop shows up and she was like, were you taking bets on this race? Mm. Naughty, naughty. Here's another fine.
Yeah.
Meanwhile, Carlos is just like working at a different restaurant. And I like how when Kaya shows up and says like, and he's like, yeah, thanks. Now I work here. And I'm like, is it that different from what you were doing before?
The tips probably aren't as good because he was working at like a touristy place before.
I just think the reaction is a bit overdone in terms of the switch over. I literally wrote down, okay, sorry, you no longer work at the Ritz. Like,
yeah.
So that, you know, he's still like, no, you're just a party girl, or not a party girl, but he's like, you're just going to come here and you just want to hook up and forget about me and whatever.
Yeah, next week you won't remember my name.
Yeah, just get out of here.
Go on, get.
You're never going to meet my, 78-year-old father because I'm, 49-year-old man or whatever. but that doesn't go anywhere. Justin, meanwhile, goes to meet with Alexa and asks her for advice, and she kisses him.
This hacky fucking movie, man. In fact, you know what? I'm getting a call right now from the movie police.
Uh-oh.
Yep. Oh, really? I did not know that. Huh. That is an interesting tidbit.
Because it's a tidbit that's interesting.
That's what they just said, actually. Yeah. No. Yeah, right. I mean, fun fact, who says that? Insane people, right? Yeah. Okay, well, you know what? I am going to go ahead and I'm going to pass that along. All right. Well, thank you very much. It was nice hearing from you. Huh. Did you know that if you show this movie... to prisoners of war, it is a war crime.
Oh.
It countervenes the Geneva Convention.
So this and waterboarding are on the same level.
Yes, and water worlding.
Oh, God. You got to watch Waterworld. No!
Could you just waterboard me, please?
Can you just not make me watch a movie where Kevin Costner talks about how you can drink your own pee? Okay, so from Justin to Kelly. Yeah, she kisses him, and Kelly sees the whole thing. But it's that movie thing where, like, because this has happened in so many movies, but it's that movie thing where, like, if you really were in that situation, you wouldn't linger on that for, like, a minute. You would immediately push her away. Because she stares, and it's going on for a bit.
Yeah. Kelly should at least see him pushing her away.
Yeah. She does not. Because he doesn't. He puts his arm up for a second. I was like, wait, is he going to grab the back of her head? What's going on here? And she says, like, you know, I want to be with you, blah, 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 blah. Carlos and Kaya make up. He says, I'm going to take you to an 8-course dinner at a 5-star restaurant. And you know what? It's a very unsafe dinner in a pool.
I think it's that pool that they have during that last scene. It's a weird thing because, like, you can walk out into the middle of it so it looks like you're standing on water. So if you ever need to fulfill your Jesus complex, this pool is right up your alley.
I don't think I would enjoy that.
You know what, dude? I don't even
I like pools. I like pools, and I like food. I don't need to combine them.
No, not even a swim-up bar or something?
Swim-up bar is different, I think, because the drink is different.
Make a nice panini or something as well?
No, I don't need that.
Because, I mean, would if you were doing, like, would you start cramping immediately? Because you're supposed to wait an hour.
I think so.
Like, you just sat there in the water eating food. You would just start getting cramps, like, right away.
Also, 8-course dinner. Oof, that sounds like a lot.
That's a bit much, isn't it? Like,
yeah, that's a lot. Alexa, meanwhile, lies to Kelly again. She says, like, you know, Justin kissed me, blah, blah, blah.
She is a garbage person. Sociopath. Yep. Like, absolutely. Don't know why they're friends with her. Do not know. Like, honest to God, if this is her usual MO, I don't understand why they're still hanging out with her.
Spring break changes you, man.
I'll take your word on that.
I don't even know. I'm assuming. Sure.
Is this where Carlos buys, like, a bunch of, like, drinks? They got, like, all kinds of drinks.
Oh,
and then
yeah.
Everybody gets up and leaves before they even take one sip. And I'm like, fuck that. If I was Carlos, I'd be like, no, you all sit down and drink because booze is expensive.
Well, because I think this is where they find out that Alexa has been lying the whole time. And yeah. I said, just take your drinks to a different table.
Yeah.
Like, if you don't want to sit with her, go stand somewhere else or something.
Yep. Mm-hmm.
Is this also where she tells... Yeah, because this is where she tells Kelly, like, she has her whole explanation where she's like, look, Kelly, I'm just jealous of you. By the way, Alexa the whole time, I don't know if she's really Southern. I doubt it because that accent is insane. But she reminds me of, like, Amy Poehler doing, like, a Southern accent in, like, an SNL sketch.
Not forget about our embarrassment where we didn't think Bill Paxton was actually Southern.
I still think he was doing a different kind of Southern accent.
Well, obviously he was because he's from Texas, but, you know, the folks from next of kin are supposed to be from, like, I believe,
Kentucky.
Arkansas? Kentucky.
Yeah.
Man, we're talking about all the way better movies in this this podcast.
It happens
next
a
of
lot.
Kin.
It happens a lot. But yeah, she's like, I was just jealous because you get a guy and Kai gets a guy and I'm always just a party girl and no one thinks of me and I'm like a second choice and blah, blah, blah. And that's why I did that. Kelly, I never meant to hurt you. And I'm like,
yes,
what?
You did. Yes, she
what?
Did. Everything she did was to hurt her and steal the fella who was interested in her away from her.
You can't do all that and be like, oh, my bad. So they're going on about that and they leave her, of course. The nerd finally finds his girl, Lizzie, and they just immediately make out.
Well, it's all been pent up for over a year, right?
Yeah, they got to, I'm assuming, talk a lot about Xena and whatever.
Oh, yeah, and paint the hotel room with their body fluids.
Oh, God.
Like, that's how pent up these two were, and I say good on them.
I mean, judging by how pent up they are, it'll take about 6 minutes.
Yeah, the wrap up garbage in this movie, it happens so fast and it's bullshit, and it's not over yet.
Nope, but we're getting there. Kelly has a solo song first, where she's very lovelorn. She's but Alexa is our hero, Nathan, because she brings Justin to Kelly. Kelly.
She is not our hero.
I love this though, because she brings them together and she's like, oh, come on, you guys are crazy for each other. I did all my bullshit and manipulated everyone, and I can't even keep y'all apart. Ain't I fun? Aren't I a stinker?
No redemption for her. No redemption for her whatsoever.
None. But Justin and Kelly start singing a duet. They finally kiss. Brandon hooks up with that cop because she shows up on the beach and is like in her bikini, and she's like, hey, I'm not on duty. And then we get to the big party finale where they're all dancing and singing, and it's another cover of a song, a terrible cover.
Yeah, they do a cover of That's the Way I Like It.
Yeah, which, I mean, isn't like a great song, but, I mean, it's still a really bad cover.
Yeah. I did note that on the choreography, there was a one point where I thought someone was going to slap on a Boston crab or a sharpshooter. The one dancer is laying this. Oh, they're in that weird pool again that has the walking stripes through it. And during this number, a dancer would be down on the floor with their and the other dancer would pick the other one's legs up. And they start to step through. I'm like, are they going to put them in a Boston crab? Like, what the fuck is going on in this movie? And then, no, they, like, pick them up or something like that. And I was like, shit, I was waiting for a sharpshooter. Hope someone's going to tap out of this thing.
Son of a bitch. You son of a bitch, Justin. Kelly don't belong to you. No, but they all just dance. And this is at minute 73 of the movie. The movie has ended. But they dance and sing for 5 more minutes, and then the credits run for another 5 minutes, so we can hit 81 minutes. That's so much padding.
Yep. And not on the girls, which I was, you know, surprised there, too.
And that is from Justin to Kelly.
Yep.
From Nathan and Brendan. To you. So Nathan, we come to the point of the show where we need to ask each other how we felt about this film. So I'll ask you, was this movie worth a watch, a drunk watch with friends? Would you commit head trauma to forget it, or would you avoid this like the plague?
I'd probably attempt head trauma to forget it.
Okay.
It's not.
I think maybe you're not going for the full tilt because there are unintentionally hilarious moments.
Exactly. And it's not offensive to the very core.
Yeah, so, it's not Postal.
Right. Or Cheerleader Ninjas or Nick Fury. None of that.
From Justin to Kelly, much better than Postal.
Much, much better than Postal.
I'm right there with you. I think head trauma. It's not a full avoid like the plague. There are moments where I just like was like totally like just befuddled at some of the decisions being made. So I'm going to go with the fact that I would attempt head trauma to forget it.
Okay.
So that is from Justin to Kelly, and we will be right back after a brief word from our sponsors. What were they thinking? And we're back.
Yes, we are back.
From outer space. We just walked in to find you here with that sad look upon your face.
Ooh, getting a little spicy for ooh. NPR.
Sorry. I got into the vibe of the musical.
Oh, I see.
Nathan, it is time for the low haiku. Why don't you tell the folks what exactly the low haiku is?
Well, the low haiku, 17 perfect syllables to describe the 73 imperfect minutes we've just been talking about for over 73 minutes. That may come down a bit in editing.
Future Brendan. Exactly. So why don't you kick us off and read us your haiku.
Okay. These were the winners. So what did the losers get? Simon Cowell's Nutsack.
I don't know which one I choose.
It's a real Sophie's Choice situation.
By the way, if that was the scene in Sophie's Choice, that movie would have been much different.
Considerably different.
Fraulein, would you like the Nutsack or be in the Justin to Kelly movie?
Nutsack, please, Nutsack.
No, I meant Justin to Kelly. No. Okay. On that note, I will read my haiku. This is a little bit of a reference to the songbook of Kelly Clarkson. Justin and Kelly, under duress to make this, made her stronger.
Very good. So you tie that in there.
Yeah. Success post from Justin to Kelly. That's what her friends call her.
Oh.
Kelly. She has the opposite thing. In the movie, she said it was Kelly for short because her full name is Kelly. Not Kellyanne or Kellifer or Calciferous. Holy shit. This movie has melted my brain. But we gave our opinions, Nathan. But what do we also say?
Well, you know, from time to time, we've been known to say,
don't take a word for it!
That's right, folks. That's what we say. Nathan, it's time to reveal what the critics say. So I'm assuming the critics did not care for this film.
They did not, no. The critics gave it a paltry 10% out of 63 reviews.
So 6.3 of the critics liked it.
Mm-hmm.
I'm assuming the audience is right there with them, right?
It's still rotten, but 39% out of 50,000 ratings.
Holy shit. That means like 20,000 people liked this movie.
Right. And if you did like this movie, according to Rotten Tomatoes, we would also like Fat Albert, The Prince and Me 2.
Oh.
First Daughter.
Oh, no.
Are We Done Yet? Not Are We There Yet? Are We Done Yet?
Why the sequel?
And Bratz.
Which has an even bigger disparity in ratings, by the way.
Yeah.
Yeah, that's weird that they recommended the Ice Cube family comedy sequel and not the original. Nah. Because as we all know, Are We There Yet is where the magic started. Are We Done Yet was just an obvious retread of things that were done far better.
Shameless
in the original
cash grab, I believe, yeah. Is the... But it, you know what? The first one did create a sitcom. Terry Crews is in it, so can't be all mad.
Well, I'm glad he's getting work. I'm not sure if the sitcom is a good
thing. Oh, you mean got work, because that show's long canceled. He did Brooklyn Nine-Nine
what?
After that.
It's not still on the air in its 12th season?
Not to my knowledge. It's on the CTV Go app, though, if you do want to watch it for free.
There you go, guys. That's how great it is. You can watch it for free. All right, well, let's get into it then. Let's take a look at these critics, see what they're saying about From Justin to Kelly. Okay, Wesley Morris of the Boston Globe went in pretty hot here. Said, what's depressing about from Justin to Kelly, whose title seems to refer to the text messages he sends her, I never even thought about that, is that it's been made without a lick of love, skill, or apparently money.
That we know that is patently false.
I'm saying 11.5 million of that we talked about, I think it was money laundered.
Oh, that's not completely inconceivable.
I think this is a secret mafia film.
Springtime for Hitler.
And Germany.
Yeah. Our late great friend of the podcast, Ken Hankey,
he loved it.
Express, he says, move over, Mariah Carey. There's a new kid in town, and she's got a movie that out-glitters glitter.
That's a negative review, right?
That's an absolutely negative review.
Because if that was a positive review, there's so many assumptions there that I didn't want to make.
Yeah, he's usually pretty spot on with the flicks, isn't he?
Yeah. Scott Tobias of the AV Club said, more than anything, from Justin to Kelly needs Simon Cowell.
Okay. Renee Rodriguez from the Miami Herald says, despite all the constant discussion of raging hormones, hot babes, and whipped cream bikini contests, this movie is Disney clean and curiously asexual.
That's true, because it's very, like we said, it's very PG, not even PG-13. So there's like a kiss, and that's basically it.
Well, we do get implied that that Brandon slept with that dude's girlfriend.
Yeah,
that's about it.
But it's also very like lightly referenced.
Yeah.
Okay. Well, this is one of the positive reviews that I found. It's from Ryan Cracknell of Movie Views, and Ryan says. So this is positive. So awful, it hits the bottom of the bad-o-meter and bounces back up to be sort of good. I haven't laughed this hard in a while. Of course, it was in all the wrong spots and mixed with an underlying groan. Positive. So, one of the 10%.
So it's positive, but it's a backhanded positive.
Yep.
And I think this one here might possibly be the same, although she might actually legitimately be pining for those old movies. But Linda Cook from the Quad City Times, real quick with her review, writes, where are Frankie and Annette?
Yep, because it's kind of a recreation of the beach movie, eh?
Yep.
Okay, I'll give one more here, and I'll try to find a good positive review. Okay, you've got Kevin N. LaForest of the Montreal Film Journal, and he says,
Esla.
A gloriously cheesy movie. The guilty pleasure to beat this summer. 3 out of 4.
Okay.
I can do it, guys. I'm from Montreal. It's fine. Don't worry about it.
Yeah, it's perfectly fine. Yeah. Well, I'm going to end on a negative note. James Sanford in Kalamazoo Gazette wrote, some people wait a lifetime for a turkey like this. And for them, from Justin to Kelly, will provide a holiday feast. A spectacularly wretched musical melodrama. 0 out of 5.
Oof. All right, well, let's get it. Let's move on to the real geniuses here. The real Val Kilmer? Yeah. Coming soon. Not real genius, just Val Kilmer. we're gonna talk about the audience here. Let's take a look. All right. Well. I pulled a number of positive reviews, I'm not going to lie, because I thought those were pretty funny. But Stephen A., we can only assume it's Stephen ML.
Has to be,
yeah. A hidden gem. Honestly, I'm so sick of everyone bashing this movie. For what it was amazing. 5 stars.
Well, my review comes from Brian P. I assume that's Brian Posehn.
Okay.
And he writes, if I could do a 0, I would. Half out of stars.
I was in Devil's Rejects for like 3 minutes.
I'm a big metal nerd.
Okay. Wayne M. Wayne Manor, the place where Bruce Wayne lives, says he or she or they, we should say they because it's a building. Says, I love this movie. I watch it when I'm sick at home. The music is fun, and it is a great feel-good movie. It isn't meant to be high art. Most of these critics need to get over themselves.
It doesn't have to be high art. In fact, a lot of the things that we watch in this show are not high art, but we enjoy them thoroughly.
Yeah.
Because they're fun. This wasn't really all that fun.
No, there's a difference. Yeah. I hate that defense. Anytime like a critic doesn't like a movie, they're like, okay, it doesn't need to be. I'm like, Roger Ebert liked a lot of like ridiculous, silly movies. He doesn't just like Oscar winners, guys. Calm down. Yeah.
My next review is from April C. Ooh. I got nothing.
April. No, I got nothing.
No. Yeah, right. But I had to pick this because she simply puts, I totally love musicals. 5 out of stars.
All right, April. Andrew H. I can only assume is Andy Hamilton, former guest of the show.
Yeah, okay.
Using Andrew, very formal. This is it's a very quick review, but I thought it was strange. Better than Snowpiercer, 5 stars.
What?
Better than Snowpiercer.
What?
That's what he said.
Fucking, we need to talk to Andy. Good Listen, Lord.
I haven't even, it's one of those movies that I keep meaning to watch, and not even having seen it, I can tell you that that review is completely wrong. Better than Snowpiercer. Even if it's the show that wasn't like super well received.
All right. Well, this one, I guess it's a little more middling, from Amber E. And she writes, I love Kelly Clarkson's voice and looked forward to this movie for a long time. It was a waste of time. So disappointing. Oh. 2 out of stars. I'm assuming it's because Kelly Clarkson was in it.
It was a bit of a twist in that review.
Yeah.
Are you sure it's not from M. Night S? wait, that's too obvious. M. N. Shyamalan. Okay, this one is from Sarah T, who I can only assume is Sarah T. I got nothing. It's not a good week for fake names, guys.
No, it's not.
This was awesome. Come on, rated poorly. It was loaded with great acting, comedy, and life theme. I loved all 3 versions. 5 stars.
Okay.
What? 3 versions?
Well, Zach S. I only assume it's Zack Snyder.
Oh, you got to read it real slow.
Okay, you sure?
Oh, no, wait, no. I don't know how long it is.
Well, it's not super long. HTTPS /// ZachZachArreyes.wordpress.com 2000/2016/01/04/from-justin-2-kelly-2003/0.5 out of stars.
I'm not going to your link, Zack Snyder. Lazy motherfucker. That's not fair. He's made some good movies.
He's also made Sucker Punch.
Yep. This is my last one, just because I thought this was crazy. It's from Jahane H. Simply says, this is the only musical I like. 5 stars.
It's the only musical he likes?
Patently insane.
That is lunacy.
That is, well, listen, I know, even as someone who doesn't care for musicals, filmed musicals, Nathan, I know you read that and you're like, no, that's not the case.
That is not the case. No, there are legitimately some musicals, some movie musicals that I enjoy. This is not one of them.
Nope. That's crazy. I think it should say this is the only musical I've watched.
It has to be. It has to be. Well, my last review comes from the late, great Brittany Murphy.
Oh,
Brittany,
no.
M here. Yeah. She writes, would not watch this again. The acting was terrible. I love Kelly Clarkson, but not in this movie. 1 out of stars.
Ooh, harsh.
Uncle Hank.
I'll never tell.
I actually just watched that one recently.
But let's talk about good stuff now, Nathan. Let's talk about what we've been watching lately, because we're getting our shots. I know you've gotten your first shot already.
Shot.
No, this is another "I've been everywhere" situation.
Yeah, I'm gonna read the lyrics. It's just shots repeated 55,000 times
until you forget what the word means. Yeah, but we're getting our people are getting their vaccinations. We're starting to come outside, although we're still being safe. We're still staying inside for the most part and watching a bunch of stuff. 72%
here in our neck of the woods.
72 in the whole province?
Yep.
Oh, okay. I saw yesterday was at 70, so that's a big, as a nice big
today's
jump.
Recording. Yep.
Nice. Well, hopefully by the time this airs, we'll be even up higher than that.
I'll be even higher.
By the time this airs, I'll have gotten my first shot already, so I'm excited about that. But we were watching stuff. We were staying inside for the most part. We're watching TV. We're watching movies. So Nathan, tell me, what you watching, bud?
Well, I recently watched the latest Frank Grillo flick on Amazon Prime called Boss Level, and it's actually a pretty fun take on the whole Groundhog Day type situation where someone finds themselves repeating the same day over and over and over again. It's got Frank Grillo in it. It's got Will Sasso in it. And I know, much to your chagrin, Mel Gibson's in it, yeah, but he is the villain. And he's the bad guy. So he actually gets his just desserts a few times in the movie because of the way the thing plays out. Right. This guy, he's reliving the same day, over and over and over again. Every time he dies, he wakes up at 7 o'clock in the morning. It's kind of like if anybody's ever seen the truth behind Kenny from South Park. It's kind of like that. And he's got to figure out why this is happening, save his ex-wife and his son, and also, of course, stop Mel Gibson.
As we would all do.
As we should. But I do recommend checking it out. It's a really cool premise, and some of the action beats in it are second to none.
And honestly, like, I won't lie, I watched that Dragged Across Concrete movie with Mel Gibson. Like, I can't say that I won't watch a movie with Mel Gibson, but I'm also just like, why are you still allowed to do stuff when people who have been accused of a lot less are quote unquote canceled? Anyway, whatever, it's fine. No, I do think that movie looks cool, though. I have heard a few things about it. Okay, Boss Level. Cool.
Yep. So what are you watching, bud?
Well, I'm currently trying to rewatch the Saw franchise. I've only watched the first two so far because they tend to run together after a certain point. I know what's going to happen once I'm past number three, especially. But I will qualified recommend the first one. I think I liked it a lot more when I saw it in theaters when it first came out.
When it first came out, it was kind of new.
It was
groundbreaking.
New.
Like, there wasn't a lot of movies like that being made at the time.
There wasn't a lot of, like, the torture porn type stuff, and that one is definitely one of the least offenders in that genre. There's moments of it, but it's not, like, throughout the whole movie. It's not that fucking movie where Alicia Cuthbert is just tortured for 85 minutes or whatever. It's a horrible movie. I don't even remember what it's called.
Is that P2?
I thought you said Me Too. I'm like, that's a horrifying title for that movie.
No.
It's called, like, Captive or something.
Oh, is it? There's a movie called P2 where this girl is basically, she's pursued through this parking garage by the same guy for, like, legitimately 85 minutes straight, it feels like.
Yeah, I don't know. Some of them, like, some of the stuff is fine. I just, like, I think sometimes it veers off into cruel a lot more than entertaining at times. But I do still think the first Saw is, like, a pretty good movie. Danny Glover's in it, and I love Danny Glover. One thing I did notice, though, on this rewatch is that Cary Elwes, who usually is a great actor, not great in this movie.
You don't feel?
No, I feel like he's overacting like crazy. I actually used to think that Lee Whannell was the one that wasn't so great, but I kind of did a 180. I think he's actually better in that movie than Cary Elwes was. Probably helps that he also co-wrote the script. But yeah, the first Saw, it's still pretty good. I also watched the second one, but we don't have to, that one's whatever. But I would recommend the first Saw movie. Yeah, if you haven't seen it, I guess. I mean, I'm sure if you haven't seen it, you probably know the twist because you know they made like 12 other ones. But check it out. I'm eventually going to watch Spiral at some point. So that's what I'm leading to.
Captivity was the...
Is that what it is? Okay. Yeah, I knew something like that. It's that's not recommended.
No, not by Rotten Tomatoes either.
No, it's pretty dreadful. Yeah. I don't even think that's a coming soon because I don't know what I would talk about. Oh, she gets tortured. Now she gets tortured again, and now she's
being
tortured
some more. Oh, she's tortured. And for a fresh take on things, she's being tortured.
It's very repetitive. but yeah, Saw. So that's it. We should talk about next week because, Nathan, we are done with Listener's Choice Month. I think we had a good time overall. I mean, we had a ridiculous movie to close out with. We had Three Ninjas, which was a lot of fun. The Encounter was kind of crazy. We don't Maximum Conviction on Patreon. That was terrible. Hashtag thanks, Brent. And then of course last week we talked about XXX State of the Union. So you know, no Postal in this. No Nick Fury, Agent of S.H.I.E.L.D. But we should talk about next week because next week is a very special episode airing on Canada Day.
Yes, sir.
So, Nathan, why don't you give us a little hint-ski? We haven't had one of these in a while as to what we've got in store.
Okay. Just gonna leave it at that. People who know.
All right, there you go. There's your hintski. But now we come to the time in the show where we bring in our friend Montrose Monkington III.
Yes, he is here. Just give me one moment and I will get him. Hello, it's your good friend Montrose Monkington III here, and I'm glad to see you chaps survived your Listener's Choice Month. It's not easy having the internet tell you what to do. Usually I just tell the internet what to do. Like, internet, you should go to my YouTube channel, Montrose Monkington TV, and you can also be friends with me at the Facebook group, Montrose Monkington III Esquire and Friends. And finally, internet, tweet at me. At Montrose III, that's the number 3RD. Thank you. More later.
Thank you, Montrose.
You're welcome.
From Montrose to Nathan. That's how we go back. That's every transition.
I'd watch that musical.
The romance is a bit weird, but
it's a little strange.
I'm not super into interspecies erotica.
There's more chemistry than Justin DeKelly, though.
Oh, a lot more. Yeah, a lot more. Man, I feel bad for everyone. Like, I feel bad for Justin and Kelly specifically, because they did not choose to be in this movie.
No, and they could have had Simon Cowell's nutsack.
Right? That would have been better.
At least it would have been over a lot quicker.
Maybe. We don't know. We don't know how well he holds his erection. On that note... you can find us on all the podcast apps. You're obviously listening to one now, but you can find us on others too. We're on everything, iTunes, Apple Podcasts, everything. Our home base is Age of Radio.
Big time.
You can go to ageofradio.org/whatwerethinking. You can also find other podcasts there like Home Video Hustle, Everything I Learned from Movies, Nerdy Bitches, my other podcast for Screen and Country with my hussy, Jason.
Homewrecker. And you know what? It's really telling who your top bitch is, because you even name checked me in an episode that I was not involved with, just knowing full well that me being involved with it, even if I wasn't, just name checking me would immediately augment it as far as its profile in the podcast community.
Oh, Nathan, don't start a war. Don't start a war. You can find us. You can also follow us on Twitter and Instagram at WWTT Podcast. Look for us on Facebook. Just search for What Were They Thinking. We are there. I promise you. TeePublic, patreon.com/WWTT Podcast. All of that. Look for us. We're out there. We're on every website ever made, ever. So, Nathan, all that being said, do you have any questions about Justin and or Kelly?
Well, I suppose I got a few.
Okay, sing them.
With a movie starring Justin and Kelly. It's a movie. They got songs and they got dancing. Can you please tell me, what were they thinking?